Zašto divlje životinje, iako često u životnoj opasnosti, rijetko ili nikad pate od trauma? To je pitanje prije više od 30 desetljeća postavio Peter Levine, liječnik i fiziolog koji je razvio inovativni pristup liječenju traume, smatrajući da svi ljudi u sebi imaju urođenu sposobnost transformacije traumatskih iskustava. Naše visoko razvijene kognitivne sposobnosti često puta nam više odmažu nego pomažu u situacijama u kojima je ipak poželjno reagirati instinktivno. Zato je razumijevanje dinamike koja divlje životinje čini praktični imunima na simptome stresa ključ razumijevanja isciljivanja traume i kod čovjeka. Iako razgovor ima ljekovitu moć, dr. Peter Levine smatra da traume ne zaostaju u našim sjećanjima, već u našem živčanom sustavu. Naučimo li ih otpustiti, tada bismo, baš poput divljih zvijeri, mogli postići trajno isciljenje. Stoga, da bi se liječilo traumu, nije nužno prizivati neugodna sjećanja, ponovno proživljavati neugodne trenutke, niti do iznemoglosti pokušavati racionalizirati sve okolnosti situacije. Već je potrebno živčanom sustavu dopustiti da kroz brižno zmišljene procese sam otpusti višak energije. Tu je tehniku Peter Levine nazvao somatic experience ili somatsko proživljavanje. S doktorom Peterom Levinom sastanak smo dogovorili ovdje, na rubu znanosti. Dobro večer. Dr. Peter Levine doktorirao je medicinu i biofiziku na Kalifornijskom sveučilištu u Berkeley te fiziologiju na Međunarodnom sveučilištu te se 45 godina bavi proučavanjem stresa i traume. Dobro večer. Kako biste objasnili što je to somatsko doživljavanje? Koja ideja leži iza tog izraza koji ste vi iskovali, somatic experiencing na engleskom?
Ok, somatic refers to the body. Experience to the experience of the body. So we have the body, that's the anatomical body, that's the physiological body. Then we also have the experiential body. How our different sensations and feelings live within inside of us, within our own bodies, and how we can learn to tune in to what's going on in our bodies. And that's why I use the term somatic experiencing, the experience in the living, sensing, knowing body.
Prije nego što vidimo dokle se nakon 45 godina došlo po pitanju učinaka prilikom rješavanja trauma ljudi, možemo se malo vratiti u prošlost. Negdje na samom početku se pojavilo ime Wilhelma Reicha. Koji dio njegovog rada konkretno je bio za vas inspirativan u ona vremena prije skoro pola stoljeća?
Well, I think Reich was one of the great geniuses of this past century. And he spoke, you know, at the time, Freud was the theory that most people believed in. But Reich said, no, this is not complete, because what people experience different emotions, and these emotions are tied up with different memories. And so just understanding something is very different than being able to feel the emotion of it. So he brought really the emotion and the life energy into the field of psychology and psychoanalysis.
Kako je iscjeljivanje traumi zapravo postalo vaš životni poziv?
Well, yes, one wonders how these things happen, how one's life unfolds. But I know as a child, I was always curious about things. I constantly was curious. And fortunately, my parents they supported that. But my beginning in understanding with trauma happened in the 1960s. I was working on some body-mind, it was a very infancy at its time, very infancy field. I was For example, I found that if I could help certain people relax certain muscles in their neck and their jaw and their shoulders, people with very high blood pressure, sometimes within 20 minutes, the blood pressure would become normal. So a friend of mine, a colleague of mine, was seeing a patient. And she had all kinds of physical problems, physical symptoms that they couldn't find a cause for. And she also had severe anxiety, so much that she couldn't leave the house without her husband. And even then, it was an ordeal. It was terrifying. It was exhausting. And he thought, maybe if I could teach her some of these relaxation techniques that I was developing, that would help her at least with the the fear, the terror, the panic attacks. So when she came in, I could see from her pulse in her neck, I could see her heartbeat was about 120 beats a minute, boom, 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 boom. And I talked a little bit with her. She was with her husband, of course. And then I began to teach her how to do some of the relaxed muscles in her neck and in her jaw. And her heartbeat started coming down. So needless to say, I was relieved. And then it went down to a normal range of about a 70, 74, 75 beats a minute. But then, boom, it shot up very, very high. And it was like about 150 beats a minute. And probably, if you can think of what's the stupidest thing that you could possibly say in that situation, that's exactly what I said. I said, Nancy, you must relax, you need to relax. But then her heart rate started coming down. So again, I was relieved, but it went down and down, and her pulse was about a 70 beats a minute, 60 beats a minute, 50 beats a minute. And she opened her eyes and she grabbed onto my eyes and she said, and she was pale, her color was pale, her face was pale. And she said, Doctor, I'm dying. Don't let me die. Help me, help me. Don't let me die. And at that very moment, I had an image of a tiger. And I saw the tiger jumping out towards me. The tiger was behind from where you're sitting. Of course, it was an image. And I said, without quite knowing why, I said, Nancy, there's a tiger. There's a tiger chasing you. Run, climb these rocks and escape. And to my amazement, her body started to shake and tremble, sometimes very trembling, and then it became slower and more subtle. I noticed her fingers became ice cold and then warm. And then this would go on for 20 or 30 minutes, and then there'd be an easy, deep, spontaneous breath. And then finally, at the end, she opened her eyes, not locking onto mine this time, but looking at me softly. And she said, Doctor, do you want to know what happened? And I said, yes. And she said, well, when you told me about, at first I felt paralyzed. I felt like I was going to die. And when you told me the image of the tiger and you said to run, at first I couldn't run. My legs were like lead. But then with your encouragement, I started to be able to run. And I could feel myself running. I could feel myself breathing. I could feel myself climbing the rocks. And then when I got to the top, I looked down and I saw the tiger, but then the tiger disappeared and I saw a picture of myself when I was 4 years old. So she was 24 when I saw her. When I was 4 years old, and I had to have a tonsillectomy. And at that time, they used ether, so the children were terrified. And so they would hold the child down, and then the doctors and the nurses, and then force the mask on the child, and the child would then breathe in the ether. So she was just completely terrified. And her body, of course, had wanted to run away, to escape. And then 20 years later, her body actually got to escape. She, in other words, she got the feeling that of what she needed to do 20 years ago. And in doing that, that was the last anxiety attack she had. And then over some few more sessions, the different physical symptoms also went away. So a few things. Needless to say, I was going to have an academic career in science. I had wanted to work with NASA, which I eventually did do. I actually was able to work with NASA on stress issues. But I realized a few things. First of all, that I could have easily overwhelmed her, because with these reactions came on very, very strong. And so I know that this is not, I wouldn't want to do that. As a matter of fact, there were some therapy methods that would basically have the person relive their traumas over and over again. And I realized that was not helpful. So I found out that gradually helping the person revisit different parts of some of these experiences like Nancy had, and feel them in her body, and then let the sensations move through her body so they no longer were caught, they no longer were frozen in her body. And by doing that, I discovered more and more people were able to heal different things that happened to them, sometimes from many, many years ago, which kept them frozen and unable to go forward in life. So this was then the beginning of my career in finding a safe method, in finding ways that I could teach it. And when I started, I had about, this was in Berkeley, California, and I had about 12 or 15 therapists who were from Berkeley, and I would meet with them every week or two, and I would try to demonstrate the work and then explain it to them and then try to get a language that I could teach it. And so now, 45 years later, we now have trained over 25,000 people worldwide to be able to do this kind of approach to help people heal from sometimes more ordinary things that have happened, but sometimes the most horrible things that have to do with war and violence and rape. And that it was possible to help people to heal from these events, not by reliving them, but by learning to have new experiences in their body, in the living, sensing, knowing body. New experiences that contradicted those of frozenness, of overwhelming helplessness. So again, the idea was not to have people relive the trauma, but learn to have new experiences in their bodies.
Kada danas pričamo o traumi, na neki način se trauma psihoterapija bavi već skoro 100 godina. Koji je pristup klasične govorne psihoterapije traumi i koji se to mehanizmi kod somatskog doživljavanja pokušavaju zapravo zaobići, a koje klasična terapija još uvijek zapravo na njima uglavnom inzistira?
Okay. Well, you know, around the time there were two main methods of treating trauma. One was called the cognitive behavior, where you would try to help people have different thoughts, because when people are traumatized, they think it's their fault and so forth. So the idea was there was to help with their faulty thinking, with their difficult beliefs. And the other approach, as I was mentioning, was having the patient relive the trauma over and over again. And I found that while it's useful, there's no question about it, it's useful to know that one is having a negative thought and the effect that it has. By itself, it's not adequate to heal trauma, because trauma is something that gets stuck in the body, and then it has to be healed in the body. So as I say, the approach is either of trying to get the person to have new beliefs or to change their behaviors or to tell them they shouldn't be angry. That had only a small effect. That the main thing was in learning to have these new experiences that said no, that trauma isn't the only thing. I can now experience my own sense of myself, my sense of vitality, my sense of connection to self. So in a way, one of the things, well, getting back to this woman who I did the session with, who I called Nancy, at the end of the session, when she opened her eyes and made contact with me, she said, when I asked her what she was noticing happening with her, she told me about running and about feeling herself running and so forth. But she said at the end, it felt like she was being held in warm, tingling waves. And the kinds of experiences that people were having, that didn't really fit in with what was known in psychology. These were much more things that people talked about in terms of spiritual experiences. And I started to realize that trauma healed, trauma resolved, trauma transformed is a great gift, restoring us to confidence, to joy, to resilience, to a sense of wholeness and compassion. And again, these were more like spiritual types experiences. So then I realized that this is not just about trauma. This is about all of our basic spiritual needs, that healing trauma would open some of these doors. I'm not saying that it is a spiritual path in itself. I mean, it can open people to these new paths. And again, I think probably the most basic experience in spiritual, all spiritual traditions, is to feel alive, to feel vibrant, to feel alive. And again, the energy that people got locked in their bodies, that those basic energies were energies that would open people to these deeper experiences.
Mi ljudi imamo na sreću ili na žalost naš racio i um. Imamo mi također druge dijelove mozga i uma o kojima ćemo pričati malo kasnije. No možda bi usporedba sa svijetom životinja dobro došla s obzirom da je već i krenulo od tigra, pa zašto napustiti tako poučno područje. Na koji način se recimo, to je dobar primjer kako se životinje u prirodi nose sa traumama. Oni imaju svoje procese koje, eto, mi ponekad i blokiramo s nekakvim svojim, rekao bih, pokušajem da dokažemo da smo jači od toga i slično. Kako to funkcionira u prirodi?
Well, that's a really important question and really comes in a way to the root of this approach. Animals in the wild, prey animals, their life are threatened on a routine basis. Once a day, twice a day, 10 times a day. You know, a rabbit is chased down by a coyote. A gazelle, impala, are chased down by cheetah in the African Serengeti. And if the animal escapes, then it survives. It lives. Of course, if it doesn't escape, it dies. But if animals develop the same kinds of symptoms that people did, that humans did, they wouldn't survive, nor the species would survive. So it occurred to me that there must be something in the animal experience that somehow we have overridden or we don't understand. What is it that we can learn from the animals, that the animals do, that we interfere with, but if we stay out of the way, then this same process that takes restores animals to equilibrium can also restore us to equilibrium. So, for example, if something happens and I'm walking home tonight and somebody comes in the parking lot with a gun and says, give me your money. Okay, so I give money. And then when I get home, somebody says, well, how was your interview? And I said, well, it was, the interview was interesting. I enjoyed being there with very interesting questions. But then when I was leaving, somebody held a gun to me, and that was my day. Well, that doesn't happen with us, right? Because we don't shake that off the way that the animals do, the way they shake and tremble, the way Nancy shook and trembled, and then gently releasing that bound up energy. So what I really was doing was helping people learn not to interfere with these processes that restore them to equilibrium just the way the animals did.
Dobro, vratit ćemo se opet nekim detaljima nakon što se malo bolje još upoznamo s vama. Naime, eto, Petar Levin prvi put je u Hrvatskoj, no tehnika somatskog doživljavanja i nije. Pa eto, kako, zašto, otkuda se i gospodin Levin i Somatic Experiencing, kako su se pojavili u Hrvatskom, u minutima koje slijede.
Peter Levin je doktor, doktorirao je psihologiju i biologiju i ono što je on pionir ili nekako prvi koji je negdje počeo proučavati traumu na drugačiji način, znači proučavajući fiziologiju ljudskog bića. I Peter Levin je, znači to je počelo negdje prije 40 godina, kada je tada je radio dosta kao terapeut, kao psiholog i došla mu je gospođa, recimo imenom Nancy, koja je trebala raditi tretman kod njega po preporuci psihijatra i u toku tretmana gospođa se jednostavno zamrznula i prestala je disati. I on je to puno puta opisao svoje iskustvo da ga ulovio nekakva vrsta straha. I prvo što mu palo na pamet da, rekao je, dolazi tigar koji će te napasti. I to je kod nje prouzročilo jedan ogroman impuls energetski koji je zašao van kroz vikanje, vrištanje, plakanje itd. I nakon toga je on jednostavno počeo dalje proučavati što se desilo sa fiziološki, sa gospođom i sa fiziologijom bića. Počeo proučavati životinje, kako reagiraju kada je nekakva stresna situacija ili traumatična. I to ona najpoznatija je bijeg ili borba koja se koristi puno u psihologiji ili zaleđenost. Međutim, kod životinja je prepoznao da one kada dožive traumu, da nakon toga jednostavno se stresu i otpuste neku vrstu stresa. Proučavanjem fiziologije dokazao je da kad dolaze do određene traume, a trauma može biti apsolutno bilo što, znači može biti i automobilska nesreća koju mi doživimo, ali isto tako trauma može biti i ako smo mi bili promatrač neke nesreće, trauma može biti operacija nekakva, trauma može biti, da ne velim, gubitak neke voljene osobe, ratne okolnosti itd. I proučavanjem fiziologije je došlo do toga da prilikom traumatičnog događaja osoba fiziološki jednostavno potencira jedan ogromni energetski naboj koji ide prema van i to je naboj koji stvarno nama služi za obrambeni sistem. I to je nešto prirodno što rade i životinje. Međutim, s obzirom da mi nismo samo instinktivna bića, nego smo i razumska i emotivna bića, mi jednostavno taj akumuliranu energiju koja se nakupi nakon traumatičnog događaja ne izbacimo van iz našeg tijela. I njegovo, ono što je potpuno novo i potpuno novost u nekakvoj, rekla bi, psihoterapiji, je da kod traumatičnih osoba koje imaju traumatični događaj ili koje su traumatizirane, ne treba ići putem sjećanja, znači na njihov taj događaj, ponovo to analizirati, ulaziti u traumatični događaj, potencirati nekakva sjećanja, nego da treba nekakvim drugim putom doći do akumulirane energije u živčanom sustavu i taj naboj treba izaći van. I to je u stvari tjelesno orijentirana psihoterapija.
Somatic experiencing se sve više i više integrira u mainstream, upravo zbog toga što sva ta istraživanja koja postoje iz neuroznanosti dokazuju na koji način naš nervni sustav funkcionira, na koji način prolazi kroz taj našu somatiku i somatic experiencing zapravo ulazi u krugove psihijatrije, psihologije, svih pravaca psihoterapije, sve više i više. Psihijatri koji pišu recepte za jako puno ljudi prepoznaju da lijekovi zapravo imaju utjecaj na taj naš centralni nervni sistem. Onog momenta kad imamo utjecaj na centralni nervni sistem, mi ne možemo raditi sa tim našim živčanim sustavom na način na koji to somatic experiencing radi. Znači, mi ne možemo biti pod utjecajem tih sredstava.
Moj doživljaj prvi što je mene potpuno privuklo, upravo taj nježan pristup, da se nekako trauma izvuče tjelesno na površinu. Znači, nema poširanja, nema guranja, nema da se osobu, ne znam, da priča o traumi. Znači, ne treba se čak uopće pričati o traumatičnom događaju, nego okolnim putevima, putem možda nekih asocijacija koje dolaze, i putem traženja kod svakog klijenta individualno njegovog resursa koji on ima, znači što je njemu snažno i jako u njemu. I kada dobimo taj resurs, u principu pomoću njega vodimo osobu da kroz određenu situaciju izvuče, znači, taj zamrznuti dio, akumulirani dio naboja energetskog unutar fizičkog tijela.
Koje je bilo tvoje iskustvo?
Moje iskustvo je bilo upravo, znači, kroz jednu vježbu gdje smo radili, Tatjana je vodila jednu radionicu, i radili smo jednu vježbu kroz, recimo, baš ono borba ili bijeg, pa smo radili određenu vrstu guranja i tako dalje, i tada sam prepoznala u sebi jedan dio moje osobne nekakvog nelagode, kako reći ne u životu. Znači, ja sam puno puta u životu ustuknula i maknula se, i kroz tu vježbu sam tijelo mi počelo drhtati i neki naboj nekako jednostavno izašao van iz mene, i ja sam se nakon toga osjećala totalno energetski puno bolje, kao da mi se neki višak energije otvorio, vratio, znači stabilnije, jače, fokusiranije, čak bi rekla možda centriranije nakon tog tretmana i nakon opće te radionice. I tada sam počela još više proučavati njegov rad, i tada se u stvari rodila ideja Tatjane i mene da zajedno nekako dovedemo doktora Levina u Hrvatsku. I evo, taj put je trajao 6 godina skoro. Prvenstveno je bilo da jedna takva tehnika, somatic experience, ako radi sa traumama, sa PTSP-om, treba na ovim područjima. Ne moramo reći samo na, ne znam, zadnji domovinski rat koji je bio, nego apsolutno, ne znam, stoljeća koja su na ovim područjima kolektivno nekako zauzimala nekakvu energetiku, i taj rad je stvarno ono fenomenalan i može puno doprinijeti svim zemljama ove regije nekako za nekakvom iseljenju.
Prije ovog razgovora sa vašim domaćinima u Hrvatskoj koje smo vidjeli u prilogu, spomenuli ste kako je svijet životinja dobra inspiracija za pokazivanje kako se nositi sa traumom, jer on jednostavno taj proces na neki način jednostavno dovedu do kraja, dok kod ljudi ostane negdje zatočena pola. O kojim se zapravo razinama uma ovdje radi? Od čega se naš mozak uopće sastoji i što je to što kod životinja uspješno dovrši proces do kraja, a kod nas bi isto moglo, ali eto, iz nekih drugih razloga i osobina koje mi imamo, a životinje ne, to se ne događa. Znači, kako izgleda iz te perspektive naš um, naše tijelo i naš mozak?
We have the capacity to think very powerfully in a way that animals most likely don't. But we also can outthink ourselves. And so, for example, if the animal escapes, that's it. It's fine. If it happens again, then it's not, you know, it doesn't lose any ability. However, if we just narrowly escape, we may go in our mind, what would have happened if we didn't escape? What would have happened? We could have been killed. We could have been really badly hurt. Even in a car, we're driving and all of a sudden somebody's coming on the wrong side and we just are able to turn our car and get away. And then we go. So our heart is pounding and so forth. So if we're using the somatic experiencing approach, the person just is with those sensations until they settle down. But if our mind gets in, it says, oh my God, I could have been killed. I would have been killed. My children wouldn't have had a father. You know, we can think of all of these things that keep replaying the trauma Whereas if we just allow the trauma to move through, then like the animals, we come back into balance, we come back into equilibrium.
Na koji način su tradicionalno, dakle, na koji način su tradicionalno ljudi rješavali one iste stvari koje danas rješavaju psihoterapeuti? Jer i tradicionalne zajednice su imale svoje psihoterapeute, to je uvijek bio u selu, u plemenu, neki vrać, šaman, stručnjak za biljke i tako. Međutim, oni su na neki način, kao bliži prirodi, imali načine koje su isprva antropolozi zapravo smatrali nekim praznovjerima, ali kada se uklopi u ovaj koncept, recimo, somatskog doživljavanja, odjednom se uočavaju zapravo principi koji se nalaze i u prirodi, i među životinjama, i među ljudima, samo na neki način se kod nas ne primjenjuju. Što ste, recimo, mogli uočiti kod tih zajednica, nazovimo ih tako primitivnih, uvjetno rečeno?
Yes. Well, I've had the privilege to be and spend time in some different so-called primitive societies and been with different shamans and watched how they worked and talked about it. And with some shamans, we've worked together with the same patient. I think clearly there are a lot of parallels in what we see in pre-literate shamanic cultures, because threat is something, and loss is something that people have experienced forever. And I think in a way, I've talked to some shamans, and they said that there are two things that shamans do to help people, two things. One is if they have sustus or xustus, which means in Portuguese or Spanish language means fright paralysis or soul loss. So the shaman very often will journey and find where the soul has become lost and bring the soul back and help the soul come back into the patient's body. It's a little bit different in somatic experiencing. We do something that in some ways is similar, but in some ways it's different. So instead of the therapist going and calling the part back, the client brings the part back that it was dissociated, that was split off from them because of the terror. So I think in many ways, somatic experiencing, although my background is in biophysics and in physiology and in psychology, I really identify more with what shamans do and into shamanic approaches. And one of the things that was also very, and I mentioned that one thing is soul loss or fright paralysis. And the other thing is if the person has had a curse put on them. So those are the two main things, and the shaman needs to know what symptoms are being caused by which. I make the main point that the shamans have needed to work with these things for millennia, for thousands and thousands of years, because human beings have had that need, and I find that this approach, I think, is something that we really have lost in psychology, and I think some understanding from anthropology and understanding of how shamans treat their patients is vitally important to understanding how we can best treat our patients.
U vašoj knjizi mogu se naći zanimljivi citati i misli. Recimo, traumu je moguće izliječiti bez brojnih sati provedenih na terapiji, bez ponovnog proživljavanja bolnih sjećanja. Traumu je lakše spriječiti nego liječiti. Trauma nije doživotna kazna. 40% ljudi doživjelo neku traumu zadnjih 3 godine. I drugim riječima, bilo bi zapravo možda uputno se uputiti u način kako se ljudi dovode u stanje da uspiju ponovo proživjeti, dakle, kroz jednu razinu osjetilnosti, koja je inače također jedna i disciplina u mnogim istočnjačkim tradicijama u kojima se zapravo pokušava osvijestiti osjetilnost. Kroz razne vidove meditacije, osvještavanja tijela, osjećavanja osjećaja i slično. Na sličan način, naravno i ova metoda ima mnogobrojne nekakve poveznice. Na kako sa vašim pacijentima, s ljudima koji imaju traumu, kako ih dovodite u situaciju da oni opet na neki način uspiju konačno proživjeti to što nekada davno nisu?
Good. Let me give you an example. Because we just had a class, a training in this approach in Zagreb. And one of the people that I worked with for a demonstration was a woman who had a lot of fear, a lot of anxiety. And when I ask sometimes people to write down the different things that have happened to them, that when she was a toddler, when she was about two or three years old, her brother and some friends of the brother locked her in a closet, a dark closet, and she couldn't get out. She was terrified. So when I started to bring her awareness into her body, she could feel that her arms wanted to push something. So I very gently had her experience this movement, this inner movement like this. And then all of a sudden, she was saying, I'm not trapped anymore. So, again, this is the idea of a new experience. There's also some neuroscience work that's very important here. And it's called reconsolidation theory. It's some experiments were done where they basically gave, they would condition a fear response in an animal. And then they would give a chemical that blocked the reformation of memory. And in doing that, they were able to reduce the conditioned fear response. So what happened with this woman is when her body could have a new experience, that old memory didn't exist anymore, where she was locked in. The memory she had now was that she pushed and opened it and put her tongue out to her brother and the friends, you know, that they couldn't scare her. That's the new memory. The old memory doesn't exist anymore. It has been reconsolidated in a new memory without injecting drugs into the brain, because in the animal experiments, that's how they do it, of course.
Općenito, kada se gleda iz dobro, da popravimo. Općenito, kad se gleda iz perspektive proživljavanja traume do kraja, zapravo lijekovi postaju tu kontraproduktivni, jer oni zapravo čovjeka, reklo bi se, zatoče u jednoj fazi i ne daju mu da prođe do kraja. Na koji način uopće je moguće do ljudi doći da oni zaista aktiviraju tu staru traumu, a da ne ostane ona i dalje skrivena? Kako se tako, rekao bih, s lakoćom dolazi do toga?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes certain drugs can be helpful for people. But drugs are being overused. They are, and part is because the drug companies are very powerful, of course. And again, I'm not anti-drug. Sometimes drugs can be, particularly some of the newer antidepressant drugs, can sometimes be helpful for, at least for a little while, to help the person be able to deal with their traumas. But by itself, it's not a solution. It's certainly not a long-term solution. So, for example, one study was very interesting. People would come into the emergency room, and so after something like a rape or a car accident, and they would routinely give them something, a benzodiazepine, to calm themselves down, because that made perfect sense. But from my understanding, I doubted that that was going to work. And I wrote letters to some of the people who, and asked them, please try to do the following study, where you you notice if they what happens in developing later post-traumatic symptoms, if they use the tranquilizers or if they don't use the tranquilizers. And the, when they did use the tranquilizers, actually people develop more severe symptoms. So if you're blocking something, again, this, the reactions that bring the body, that bring the nervous system, that bring the spirit back into balance, you know, and then you do something that interferes with that, well, that's not going to be, that's not going to be helpful. So again, I want to make it clear that it's not, I'm not anti-drug, I'm not anti-medication, but I do think they're overused, and that really when they override our own innate capacity to rebound, then they cause problems.
Osim pojedinačne traume, bavili ste se i društvenim traumama, kolektivnim traumama, i to doista nije tako beznačajna stvar kako se može za početak činiti. Evo, čak ste spomenuli i istraživanje Jamesa Prescotta koje se zapravo bavilo učincima odgoja novorođenčadi na razvoj nasilnog ponašanja u domorodačkim društvima Australije, pa se pokazalo da su društva koja su prakticirala čvrste veze s djecom bilježila niske stope nasilja, društva koja nisu bila u tjelesnom dodiru i koja su prakticirala tjelesno kažnjavanje i bilježila su jasne tendencije prema nasilju u smislu rata i slično. Imali ste čak i osobna iskustva, konkretno u Norveškoj ste radili sa majkama novorođenčadi, ali te majke su pripadale na neki način sukobljenim ili oponentskim stranama. Što vam je taj rat pokazao po pitanju kolektivne traume i na koji način se somatsko doživljavanje može i proširiti izvan okvira osobe i onog što je ona proživljavala kroz život?
Also a very beautiful question, especially for this region here. When you said that this was the first time it came to Croatia, it's actually not. At the very end of the war, I was part of a peace conference that was happening near Dubrovnik. And I was also working with a number of the adolescents and children who have been traumatized by the war. And it brings me a lot of gladness to come here and to see that in wartime, these things tend to continue. You know, very often every 20, 25 years after a war ends, another war begins. And I really see how people are starting to begin also to heal the collective trauma, and also to heal the effects that the war and the violence, and then the things that go along with war and violence, which is a lot of rape and sexual abuse, often the fathers or uncles that are coming back from the war, they're in a very traumatized state and then act this on the children. But I see a deep commitment of the people here, of the therapists and young people. And I look forward to also having more contact with people from some of the other parts of the of these different regions. But I have a very positive feeling that that people are starting to change. Let me give you an example. When I was teaching a class in the Middle East, this was before the last intifada between the Palestinian and the Israeli. I was teaching a class in Jerusalem, but we were able to also to have Palestinian mental health people coming to the training as well. And at one time I was working with this man. Somebody asked the question, can you work with somebody if you don't know what the trauma is? And I said, oh yes. You just need a symptom. So this man volunteered. He was a very, very well-known psychoanalyst who had pioneered work with the Holocaust survivors. And he said that he had a back pain for 30 years, and was constant pain for 30 years. So I said, okay, Chaim, then come, let's sit together. And I began to help him to become aware of the tension that was underneath the physical pain. And then he was able to discover that the tension was different on either side, on both sides. And then we could feel the difference in the tension. He felt his body twisting, and he could feel himself falling backwards. And then he had this memory, these pictures of he was an army doctor, there was an ambush. He fell off the back of the truck into a ditch, so he wasn't killed, but everybody else was, and brutally. And you could see that there was perspiration, there was water all around him as he was discharging this terror that he had experienced and the guilt that he survived and others didn't. And so afterwards, I asked people if anybody wanted to share some of what they were experiencing. Because again, everybody's affected by when somebody does, you know, a piece of work like this. And this one woman, I never forget, she was this really strong, handsome woman from Gaza Mental Health. And she stood up and she said, Chaim, when you asked to work with Dr. Levine, I was hoping that you would be traumatized because your people have traumatized my people, have killed my people, have humiliated my people. I just wanted that you would know the same thing for yourself. And I can't explain it. When I let myself feel together with what you are feeling, I felt such compassion for you and compassion for all of us. And I realized that until we find peace within ourselves, we will never be able to find peace with each other. So, and this is why I'm very excited to be here in Croatia and to work with people who are finding that peace within themselves so that there doesn't maybe have to be another war or some other thing like that.
Gospodine Levin, hvala vam i sretan put gdje goste uputili. Sad kad je slušalica na mjestu, da kažem još jednom, gospodine Levin, sretan put i hvala vam na gostovanju.
Thank you. It's really good to meet you and to be here.
Doviđenja. Evo, hvala i vama na pažnji. Proučavanje traume pokazalo je da naša tri dijela mozga koji čine jedan um imaju zapravo kapacitete za razrešavanje traumi, no potrebno je naučiti se fluidno kretati između instinkta, emocija i racionalne misli. Kad su ta tri izvora usklađena i međusobno izmjenjuju senzacije, osjećaje i misle, onda će naš organizam funkcionirati na način kako je to priroda i zamislila. Bez jasne povezanosti sa tim vlastitim instinktima i osjećajima zapravo ne bismo bili niti u stanju osjetiti povezanost ili pripadnost ovom planetu, obitelj ili bilo čemu drugom, a upravo nepovezanost sa osjetilnim dojmom pripadnosti čini korijen traumi. Dok bi rješavanje traume zapravo bilo integriranje tog našeg slavnog trojednog mozga, tada postajemo u stanju živjeti sve svoje prirodne kapacitete. Tada. A sada, laku noć.